Politico dropped an excerpt from Donna Brazile's upcoming book dealing with the issue of what took place during the 2016 presidential election. The book is called Hacks, the Inside Story of the Break-ins and Breakdowns that Put Donald Trump in the White House. Of course, Donna Brazile was the interim chair of the Democratic National Committee when Congresswoman Debbie Wasserman Schultz stepped down on the eve of the DNC convention in Philadelphia. In her book, she details exactly the deal that was cut between Congresswoman Debbie Wasserman Schultz and the campaign of Hillary Clinton, giving them absolute control over the politics, the process, as well as the resources of the Democratic National Committee. This has caused lots of consternation. Senator Bernie Sanders supporters say it is the smoking gun. They say supports their notion that the Democrats had the primary rigged against Senator Sanders in favor of Secretary Hillary Clinton. You have folks who are calling Donna Brazile a turncoat. Others are calling her a whistleblower. Others are saying she is bringing light to darkness. Well, let's talk about this thing with our panel. Of course, with Brandon Cooper, chair of Prince George's County Republican Party. We have Amber Phillips also on the show, Cleo Monaco. All right, folks, here's what is interesting when I read the story, and I saw several things that just jumped out at me. I looked at the fact that when President Obama when he won in 2012, he shifted a significant amount of his debt from his campaign over to the Democratic National Committee, putting them in a financial hole. They were in that hole in 2014. You get to 2016, they're still in that hole. And essentially, they cut a deal to say, look, they needed Hillary Clinton's campaign to pay their bills. That's what set up this whole deal here. The deal was cut. Donna Brazile said as a vice chair of the party, she and other officers had no idea this even existed. And it wasn't until she became the interim chair when she began to find out what the situation was. And so people are talking about Hillary Clinton, talking about Debbie Wasserman Schultz. And I'm going to ask the question. I know a lot of black folks out there are not going to like it, Cleo. But the bottom line is this here.
They're all black here, not just me. I'm not the only black person here.
No. I don't mean on the panel. I mean the folks who are watching.
Okay.
If people love President Obama, he was over the party. He picked the chair. So I'm just curious how should he not accept some responsibility for the party being in utter disarray?
Well, if he put it in disarray financially, of course he should accept responsibility. But what does that look like at this point? He's moved on.
That's
you know, he's doing other things. He's building museums in Chicago and stuff.
It's expensive to elect the first black president to the White House. Of course that ran some money. The amount of door knocking he did, the amount of innovation Barack Obama did around text messaging, voter outreach, turning out people before 2 months before the election.
So you say that $25 million was reparations?
Sure.
That's a good point that she brings up about the turnout and Roland. You talked about this last year. Addition to the fundraising agreement and in addition to her control in DNC, you talked about last year how they were not registering voters as much as they should have. And the reason speculated was because a lot of the new voters that are being registered were skewing towards Sanders. And so I remember you talking about that last year. So you're right. There is a definitely a contrast between what happened in Obama's era versus
Amber, I understand your point, but here's the deal, though. If you run a campaign and you shift debt, I got it. But then isn't it your job to also raise the money to pay off the debt? Because your election was in 2012. You still had midterms in 2014. You still had state races, gubernatorial races. You still had a presidential election in 2016. And so this whole story, this excerpt of the book, and first of all, everybody understand, Donna's book comes out on November 7th. Mm-hmm. This was an excerpt of the book, so it's a lot more what's going to be talking about next week when they actually start reading the book.
Yeah.
This all was tied to money.
Right.
It was tied to the party being broke. It was tied to deals being cut. And I'm telling you, so people are going to say, oh, my God, you trying to blame the brother. No. In 2014, President Obama concluded that Hillary Clinton was the person who should follow him in terms of in the White House. And so I'm sorry, if I'm the leader and I'm saying, look, I don't care who else run, that's who should replace me. Are they not going to line up behind her?
Well, I mean, to place all of that on Obama is just not fair. When we look at who's responsible, one, Planned Parenthood did an early endorsement of Hillary Clinton. You had Emily's List, who was backing Hillary Clinton, one of the biggest political PACs in our country. You have multiple people who were aiding this push towards getting this person in office. One, that does happen when you're talking about shifting power when it comes to gender and race. However, I will say this about Hillary Clinton. We're looking at, this will be the second time a Clinton would have the opportunity to run for the White House. I don't know about you, but in my family, I'm the second person in my entire family to even go to college. So when we start to have this conversation again, it's heartbreaking that we can now see, when we're saying rigged, what I saw in Donna Brazile's excerpts is she's talking about a handful of people having control over hiring decisions, having control over mailings, monies, and all the, and that has always been the case for both parties. We have a very limited amount of people who are deciding not only how we turn out voters, but who's capable of running. So that's why I say this is a conversation about gatekeepers.
But Amber, you're missing it. This is what I mean, Brandon. What I'm trying. And so this is not, oh, I'm putting all on him. This is very simple. In a corporation, your CEO runs a corporation. Mm-hmm. Your CEO is going to be held responsible for what happens in a corporation. The point I'm making is this here. When I look at the mess that's in the Democratic National Committee, I'm sorry. When I go back to 2008, Obama wins. He gets rid of Howard Dean. He puts in Tim Kaine. Tim Kaine runs for United States Senate in Virginia. He puts in Congresswoman Debbie Wasserman Schultz. After the 2012 election, numerous Democrats were saying to the president, you've got to get rid of, no, after the 2014 midterms, numerous Democrats were saying to the president, you got to get rid of Congresswoman Debbie Wasserman Schultz. She's not raising money. She's not leading. He chose not to.
Right.
All I'm saying is, and again, if you read that article, Brandon, you read that piece, Donna, she checks Hillary Clinton, she checks Debbie Wasserman Schultz, she also checks President Obama.
She was dropping.
And so Democrats need to be stepping back and saying, you know what? This ain't just one person or two people. This was party leadership.
Right.
To Amber's
had
point.
A party in disarray.
It was the gatekeepers you talked about. And like you said, Donna was dropping names, bringing receipts. She was talking about all the shadiness that happened last year. And to your point, back to the conversation about Obama, this is, I think, part of the problem is that sometimes we, memorialize some of these public figures. I respect Obama, I love Obama, but he was not, perfect. And you're right. One of the things that will be of his legacy is the state of the DNC under his reign.
Let me finish, Amber. They lost 600 seats in the state local offices.
You lost 600 seats to Republicans under Obama's reign. As you said, they were in debt. And it's current today. Even though congressional Democrats are outraising Republicans, the DNC is having record lows. And so people do not trust the DNC. Democrats don't. But they're trusting the candidates.
So Cleo, hold on one second.
I got to get Cleo in. Mm-hmm. So Cleo, what has to happen here, if folks just go, oh, my God, this, what has to happen here, if Democrats want to move forward, it has to be a clear, open accounting of how did we get in such a state? How did you go from electing Obama in 2008, reelecting him in 2012, and then, as it's fact, losing 1,000 seats across the state? In that position, you have to analyze your entire infrastructure and analyze the folks who are making those decisions to say, how do you move forward? Cleo.
I agree with you completely, and I'm always down for accountability. But what gets in the way of accountability, particularly when you talk about Obama, is the investment that some of us have into memorializing him, as you mentioned, and making him, greater than America or whatever term you want to use. But the accountability factor is always important. But even when he was president, we black folks were not holding him accountable. Mm-hmm. So I don't think we're going to hold him accountable now. And this becomes just intellectual discourse because, like I said before, the man is gone. And I don't think he's going to say, hey, y'all, I'll give you a $25 million check now.
No.
He's
see,
a Virginian.
See, this is the mistake. He's no longer the president. Still holds significant sway in the party. And what I'm saying is, this is what I'm still trying to understand. This is just me. And again, I'm not in any party. I'm not on any committee. But if my party's broke, and I haven't seen this. If my party's broke, I'm trying to figure out why Obama, Bill Clinton, Hillary Clinton, Senator Elizabeth Warren, Senator Bernie Sanders, Senator Kirsten Gillibrand, Senator Kamala Harris, and let's say three more other major names, aren't on this nationwide 90-day blitz to raise, let's say, $10 million to erase the debt, to be in the black, because here's the piece. If you don't have those resources come next year, you're not retaking the House. You're not retaking the Senate. You're not putting a dent in gubernatorial mansions. And so while the Bernie people and the Hillary people are sitting here, oh my God, slapping each other, yelling, I'm going, hey, y'all better wake the hell up.
But Roland, has anybody ever done that kind of campaign and fundraising campaign with that focus after?
Yes.
Has it been that much debt?
So yes. let me just make Actually, this, I just want to make this ahead. One quick point, going back to something that you said earlier, Roland, is that even the fact that you can make a comparison to corporations to our U.S. democracy is a problem. In the spirit of the person I am wearing on my chest today, Shirley Chisholm, who ran on being unbossed and unbought, that until we deal with the fact that it takes millions of dollars for one person to run for office, we are going to continue to sell ourselves short. We are going to continue
Amber,
to have... We're going to... I'm addressing what you're saying.
Amber,
what I'm, my
CEO.
Point is... But exactly.
I said CEO.
My point
no,
is.
Amber. Mm-hmm. Nonprofits have CEOs.
What I'm they
no, no,
don't.
See, I'm
they
not speaking to corporations.
But that doesn't make it
no,
right.
No, no,
that
no.
Does, my point is, Roland,
Amber,
that doesn't
Amber,
make it.
Amber, every. Amber,
I agree
if
with you.
If you have an organization, if you have an organization, you can have leadership. So the point of CEO is not it's a corporation. I'm making the point that I don't care if it's a for profit, if it's a nonprofit, if it's a university, leadership has to assume responsibility for failure. That's the point, not a corporation.
I completely agree with you, but I'm saying that the answer is campaign finance reform. That's it.
No. Again, here's the deal, though. You can have campaign finance reform. You can raise money for small donors.
Hillary raised more than Trump.
You still got to take care of your money from small donors. It requires leadership. That's all I'm saying.
Weekdays on TV One.
I will never lie to you.
Oh, my God.
Roland Martin.
He doesn't want to talk to us. He wants to ignore us.
Uncensored.
Hell no.
No.
That ain't gonna cut it, boo.
Unapologetic.
No, that is fundamentally false. You are wrong.
Unfiltered.
He wants an America where we all look alike. He ain't talking about black people.
Unrelenting.
You better go work out, because you got a fight on your hands.
News One Now with Roland Martin, weekdays at 7 a.m. on TV One.